We have another exceptional top eight game for you here as we finish off this side of the bracket. We will be watching Paul Chua face off against Melvin Kay. Melvin and Yuri are two remaining international players at the North American International Championships. You can see Melvin on the right, Paul on the left. Melvin repping his country. He's certainly made Singapore proud by making it to the top eight. Can make them even prouder by winning this and advancing to the top four.
Yeah, I mean, it's a big deal when you're playing in another country like this. There's not a whole lot of international competitors, so very impressive that these guys were able to make it as far as they did. They've been doing great at previous international championships this year as well, so perhaps we shouldn't be so surprised that they've made it this far.
Absolutely. Two incredibly talented and decorated players here coming up for this top eight match, both of whom we have seen quite a bit of over the course of this weekend. No surprise, of course, knowing that these two players were likely to make it through at least top to the top 32 for day two and now into the top eight.
Yeah, I mean, they've done it at a number of previous events this year, and there's a reason why they have the travel awards to be participating in this event, right?
Yeah.
Now, they're given to the top players in each region, so naturally, these are the guys that you don't want to see yourself paired up against.
Yeah, and Paul Chua is one of the most dangerous people to find yourself across the table from when you're at an event like the North American International Championships. You can obviously see his placements and previous nationals, previous worlds, and regionals here in North America, as well as an international finalist last year at this event. The team that we've seen quite a bit of, the Kangaskhan, Landorus, Cresselia, Heatran, Tapu Fini, and Kartana. Paul has proven himself to be a very powerful pilot of that team.
Yeah, he's kind of the one big Mega Kangaskhan player in North America, sort of made it a thing after it started becoming more popular in Japan. And it'll be interesting to see how Paul pulls through this one. You know, like you mentioned, he made it all the way to finals last year and just wasn't quite able to get over the edge. Mm-hmm. Maybe he'll do it this year. We saw him lose on stream earlier against Yuri, who looked like he was in some trouble on the main stage. So Paul may not have to deal with that one again.
Yeah, well, he will have to get through Melvin Kay to get there first. No slouch himself, the Singaporean who has dominated the competition here in North America, in Columbus. You can see top four already in an international championships this year, the Hong Kong Open champion and the Singapore Open runner-up back in his home region. Of course, the team that we have seen a few times on stream this weekend, Tapu Koko, Milotic, Landorus Therian Form, Charizard, Snorlax, and Tapu Lele.
And it's been a weird Snorlax drought lately where it seems like we saw a bunch of Snorlax at the beginning of the tournament, not so much in Top Cut, but
Melvin, and then we've just seen a few Melvin games.
Right, yeah. It seems like he's the one Snorlax player right now. Also the one Milotic player right now. Mm-hmm. There's nothing too out of the norm on his team, but we're kind of at the point where all of the players in Top Cut are just doing things a little bit differently than one another, and it'll be interesting to see how big of an impact Snorlax can make. We've kind of seen it go both ways so far, where either it's match changing or kind of just hangs out for a while and doesn't get too much done.
All right, well, we are ready for our first game here of this top eight set. Paul Chua versus Melvin Kay. The winner will advance to the top four. The losers tournament will end here. Team preview for both of these players. They should be very familiar with each other's teams and archetypes by now. But once you're in game, it's a whole different ball game.
Definitely. I think one thing that's interesting to note about Paul's team here, we've seen similar teams to what he's running, but with Mega Metagross and Incineroar over Heatran and Kangaskhan. Not having that extra Intimidate might actually help a lot in this matchup because it make Milotic easier to deal with. But you know, some of the trade-off of that is that Kangaskhan's going to have a little bit harder time brawling with some of these other Pokemon too. Also has no fire weakness. That Heatran looked like a liability the last time we saw Paul on stream. Very good in the Charizard matchup, so hopefully we'll get to see Heatran do a little bit more of his time where last time it went down in a single turn.
Yeah, Heatran is one of my favorite Pokemon from the past couple of games, so it's always exciting to see Heatran actually do work on stream. Used to be one of the most dominant Pokemon in the format. Now, just sort of the starring role on, just sort of a secondary role, rather, on Paul's team. But of course, Melvin over there, it would be interesting. This may be one of the times we actually see that Milotic actually used in this tournament. For the most part, we've just been seeing that threat of the Milotic dissuading people from bringing all of their Intimidate users.
Yeah, you have to imagine, it's tough for Paul not to select Landorus and Heatran. Mm-hmm. Certainly at least one of them will come. So Milotic will have a positive matchup against something, but still doesn't necessarily mean it will come. There's a lot of important Pokemon in this matchup. And again, you know, Melvin's going to have to make some room for his Mega Evolution to shine here. Definitely expect to see Landorus or Snorlax alongside it to hopefully get some ground-type attacks on that Heatran.
All right, well, here we go into game right now for the first game of our top eight match here. Paul Chua will be leading with Kangaskhan and Heatran matched up against Melvin's Charizard and the Tapu Koko. And Heatran already getting the matchup that it wanted up against that Charizard.
Yeah, seeing a lot of the most important Pokemon in the matchup right off the bat. Mm-hmm. Kangaskhan Fake Out Pressure does help Heatran out here, but Tapu Koko is going to probably be a big difference maker in this matchup as the naturally quickest Pokemon on the field. Nothing else can be able to outpace it without an item like Choice Scarf or a move that alters the speed of Pokemon. Charizard can do big damage to almost everything on Paul's team, but Heatran really is that wall that needs to protect Paul. And important for him not to lose Heatran too early in the match. The threat of switching in with that Flash Fire ability, which negates fire-type attacks and increases Heatran's power as a big deterrent for Charizard.
All right, well, looks like Tapu Koko, the fastest thing on the field, is the fastest at leaving the field as well. Switches out for the Landorus Therian form on Melvin's side. Gets that Intimidate down onto Kangaskhan, which we've seen be really important. You know, Mega Kangaskhan in the past was an incredibly heavy hitter. Now, with some of the changes made to its Parental Bond ability, those Intimidates are even more useful. Mega evolving right away, though, will be the Kangaskhan. And a Protect comes out from Melvin's Charizard, so no Mega Evolution on Melvin's side just yet. We are going to see the Fake Out onto the Landorus on the switch-in, though, so some damage onto Landorus. And a Substitute coming out from Heatran. Going to go ahead and protect itself from a Landorus ground-type attack.
Yeah, that's a really, really good spot for Heatran. We often see Charizard that can't actually damage Heatran anymore. Like, literally can't, where usually two Fire-type attacks and Tailwind. Because if you have Solar Beam, you almost literally can't damage it. So definitely going to be no option for Melvin to break that Substitute and then use an Earthquake. Mm-hmm. So suddenly that Heatran's already becoming a bigger problem. Not only is it deterring Charizard, but Landorus is going to take a lot of damage if Heatran gets a hold of it with a Fire-type attack as well.
Yep. And of course, Charizard deciding not to Mega Evolve that turn because Melvin knows that Heatran is a danger and a threat. Doesn't want to give it even more boosts for free. Kangaskhan will switch out for Cresselia, so bringing that levitating Pokemon out on the field. Heatran able to go for a Protect here, trying to preserve that Substitute as much as possible. Just rearranging the team here, trying to get a good position here. That attack into the Protect.
Yeah, Landorus fanning at an Earthquake there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, an entire whiff of an Earthquake onto all Pokemon on the field while Tailwind set up by that Charizard.
Yeah, Charizard just functioning as a support Pokemon here. It looks like it's not even Mega Evolving. Certainly we know it does have that Mega Stone, but not trying to activate the Drought. Mm-hmm. Just trying to play it safe here. The nice thing for Charizard is that Paul's having a hard time threatening a bunch of damage to it also, but it's certainly going to take more damage back from Heat Waves than it's going to dish out to Heatran given the Substitute and the immunity to Fire-type attacks.
Yeah, big switching with Cresselia there on a Tailwind turn always threatens a Trick Room as well to turn that Tailwind tipsy-turvy.
Also threatens Ice-type attacks and that Landorus. Certainly not going to want to stick around and try to keep breaking Substitutes when you're staring Cresselia down.
Yeah, Heatran behind a Substitute with a Cresselia next to it. I'm getting flashbacks. Landorus will have to retreat immediately from this for Snorlax. Melvin, it looks like, may be predicting a Trick Room coming out. Charizard will go ahead and Mega Evolve, so the Drought will be in play now. So powering up Charizard's own Fire-type attacks and also Heatran's Fire-type attacks on Paul's side. So Melvin trying to get some damage off onto this Cresselia before Paul can start using that Heatran to full effect. A lot of damage thanks to the Sun boost there, but Cresselia will be able to just eat its berry and heal up a little health like with that Citrus Berry.
Absolutely massive overheat, but it looks like Heatran's about to respond.
Yeah, Heatran takes that overheat from Charizard and raises a Heat Wave, dealing solid damage to both that Snorlax and the Charizard, the Mega Charizard, while Trick Room is going up.
Yeah, great call on that Trick Room, and a great call by Melvin as well, anticipating that Trick Room would come in and getting Snorlax. Unfortunately, it doesn't help as much as you might imagine. Snorlax is the Pokemon that Melvin wants in to help deal with this Trick Room, but it's definitely not going to have an easy time setting up in the face of Heatran firing off these Fire-type attacks in the Sun. Cresselia is certainly much less threatening, but still a tough spot.
All right, well, it is going to be a high horsepower coming out from Snorlax, the one Pokemon that can actually deal damage to that Heatran. But unfortunately, thanks to the sub, Heatran takes no damage, just has the substitute fade. Another heat wave will put Snorlax into berry range, so we'll be healing off the damage from that heat wave. Charizard, Mega Charizard taking a good amount of damage back from those two heat waves as well. And it looks like we're actually going to see the Toxic coming out from Cresselia. Super powerful against a Pokemon like Cursed Snorlax that really needs to take some time to get going. Overheat onto Cresselia. Now after some special attack drops, is going to deal a little bit less damage this time around, while Snorlax is going to start getting those Toxic timers going.
And Charizard now almost as unthreatening to Cresselia as it is to Heatran, but it's got the damage done. That's a ton of damage done on Cresselia. The Toxic is a big deal, though. Mm-hmm. Not knocking out Cresselia before it can get the Toxic on Snorlax kind of prevents it from being a long-term win condition. Certainly, Paul's going to want to be careful and avoid getting hit by too many high horsepowers.
All right, well, Paul will be retreating his Cresselia to bring in Kangaskhan. While Heatran protects, looks like Paul's trying to maneuver to get another substitute up for the Heatran, especially having that Mega Charizard still on the field, not threatening anything now, with a third overheat, this time dealing pitiful damage to the Mega Kangaskhan. So Paul really playing this well, being able to cycle his Pokemon around, putting Heatran in a really strong position to potentially be able to set up another substitute.
Well, the good news for Charizard is its special attack can't get any lower. That was three overheats. But yeah, great play by Paul. He can go for the fake out on Snorlax and try to get another substitute up if he wants to. He also just threatened a bunch of damage with Charizard kind of being so unthreatening at this point. Like you can imagine Melvin is tempted to switch it out for something that can do something, but dangerous now, or you don't want to give up a free attack for that switch either.
All right. Well, it looks like we are just going to see the fake out onto that Snorlax. Deals a lot of damage, actually. Snorlax maybe just not even could even just be taken out by another heat wave, but Heatran instead will be putting up the substitute to go for some long-term stability here. And the flinch and the toxic poison really adding up on that Snorlax while the overheats from Mega Charizard are fizzling out.
Yeah, I mean, I guess the damage is slowly adding up in Kangaskhan, where it's now become a non-inconsequential amount of damage. But I wouldn't be surprised here. I think what Paul is looking for is a protect. Like, he doesn't, he could just knock out the Snorlax if he wants to, but I think the goal is to keep the substitute so that when Landorus comes back out later, yep, you're still protected. So because of that, yeah, I mean, Kangaskhan will probably just go for an attack here on that Snorlax slot, try to play around any potential recycle. Don't want it around to deal with that substitute.
Yep, Heatran will just protect this turn, protecting the substitute, protecting from any ground-type attacks. And no damage able to come off onto the substitute while we're actually going to see the return on the Mega Charizard. So picking up the KO there and letting the Toxic Poison knock out Snorlax at the end of the turn.
Yeah, I was kind of expecting Melvin might anticipate this and use Recycle. Not so. A little bit of a desperation there, perhaps. But Landorus switching in will still be pretty good. You get that Intimidate on Kangaskhan. You're sort of threatening ground-type attacks on Heatran, but a little dangerous at this point where, you know, it can't be Earthquake, so you've got to be careful with the any potential Z moves, because that's the only option. And with Tapu Koko on the team, you'd assume Landorus does not have that option.
Yep, well, Tapu Koko finally out alongside the Landorus, so there are finally two Pokemon that, if they're able to move before the Heatran, can actually break the substitute and then allow the Landorus to knock out that Heatran with a ground-type attack. But it's been a lot to get there.
Yeah, and now Melvin's gonna have to give a bunch of resources just to get rid of Heatran, right? I mean, two attacks at least. Paul switching out, kind of feeling out the situation.
Yeah, and we have the Cresselia coming back. We still have not seen the fourth Pokemon that Paul has brought to this match. Tapu Koko going for another Protect here, and we are gonna see the Rock Slide coming out from the Landorus. Not able to pick up the KO on the Cresselia, but is able to deal damage to it. The substitute able to withstand that as well. And Heatran hitting into the Protect with that Earth Power.
Yeah, trying to take out Tapu Koko, but not able to do so. Does see that Landorus uses Rock Slide. That's good information considering this team. You know, with Tapu Koko on the team, you would expect Landorus is either holding in a defensive item or a Choice Scarf. If it's Choice Scarf, you know, locked into Rock Slide, so Heatran no longer has to worry about those ground type attacks.
And Heatran is still worried about other attacks, though. Tapu Koko still threatening, goes for another Protect to keep that substitute healthy. Blocks an attack from the Landorus, rather. That's another Rock Slide. Cresselia will faint this turn, but Heatran totally protected against the Tapu Koko and the Landorus right now. Well, Sort of.
Mostly protected.
Mostly protected. 75% protected from the Tabu Koko.
The poor substitute, unfortunately, not protected at all. Likely, after the damage from the rock slide, this will be enough to at least bust the substitute, but no longer a threat of a Z move, no longer a threat of a ground-type move, so Heatran's still sitting pretty, and Kangaskhan's going to be able to come back in, do some more damage, and we still have a fourth Pokemon to worry about.
Absolutely. Kangaskhan able to threaten more fakeouts. The substitute does go down thanks to that Gigavolt Havoc hitting through the Protect, but Kangaskhan or whatever the fourth Pokemon Paul has decided to bring should be more than enough to keep this Heatran healthy and able to start getting some KOs of its own.
Yeah, I mean, still sort of a dangerous situation for Paul. Have to be careful with Rock Slide flinches if you don't check Landorus.
Always. Another fake out will come out from the Kangaskhan. Knows that Landorus can't protect from it, so just going to try and get that Pokemon off the field. Thunderbolt from the Tapu Koko will deal a lot of damage, but not quite enough to pick up the KO there. Heat Wave connecting on both Pokemon will be able to not quite pick up the KO on the Landorus, but the burn will do it.
And there you go. Certainly Melvin, you know, probably expecting the Thunderbolt to knock Heatran out. And even if it wasn't, that's kind of the only out. Certainly solo Tapu Koko going to have a hard time here, not able to do large amounts of damage to two different targets at the same time. So it looks like Paul Chua is going to take our first game.
Yeah, and Melvin may not even be able to deal enough damage to see the next Pokemon in the back. The Dazzling Gleam only able to pick up the KO on Heatran. So Paul Chua's Kangaskhan should be able to get this KO with return and not even show the final Pokemon.
Yeah, it's kind of adding insult to injury there, or maybe just injury to injury, because in addition to losing that first game, it does hurt his odds in game two. Always like to know how your opponent is trying to play the matchup.
Yep.
Melvin didn't end up learning something very important there about how Paul's valuing this matchup. What he did learn is that he's got to lead something that gives him a better way to deal with that Heatran.
Yeah.
He wound up having to ignore it for a little too long, and he never really got control. Substitute was up almost the entire game.
Mm-hmm.
Paul played a very strong support game there, and you kind of see the difference between this Kangaskhan and the one from 2015. It did a bunch of damage, but it wasn't really this central to Paul's offense. Instead, it was used mostly to enable other Pokemon success in this matchup, Heatran, while doing some solid damage as it did.
Yeah, you have to imagine, you know, Melvin just can't lead that Charizard into a potential Heatran again. Having that Charizard out there for so long, unable to do anything to Heatran, making sure that Paul was always able to keep that substitute, never feeling any real threat from it, has to be an obvious adjustment for Melvin.
Yeah, kind of wisely. Paul basically just ignored it, too.
Mm-hmm.
What, he used 5 or 6 overheats? I don't think I've ever seen that before, but why not, right?
It's, yeah, we might have run out of power points.
It's a real chance. It's a wise play by Paul, too, right? You know, it's like, well, you're not threatening. I'm trying to set up anyway. So, all right, Charizard, let's just hang out for a while. Let's be pals. Melvin's going to want to do something a little bit more aggressive this time. It's less of a friendship strategy. And it's going to be tough. You know, he doesn't have a lot of great ways to deal big damage to Heatran. We talked about that Milotic before game one. At least it has super effective attacks, though. It's not great at tangoing with Kangaskhan itself. He's going to have to try something. Certainly the leave Charizard out strategy doesn't seem like the play.
All right, well, if Singapore wants to advance to top four, Melvin K is going to have to make something happen in this game two of our top eight matchup. Paul Chua, in dominating fashion, took that game one, putting Melvin on the back foot. But we're going to have to see some adjustments, and adjustments we do see. Landorus and Snorlax from Melvin's side, and Kartana and Cresselia from Paul's.
Well, we see a different Pokemon now, and no way we'll know if Kartana was the fourth last game or not, but a really good adjustment by both sides. Melvin, playing game one again, brought both of his Pokemon that have attacks that are super effective against Heatran. Paul, instead playing game two, anticipated these adjustments by Melvin and has brought a matchup likely expecting to see the Pokemon he's facing.
Absolutely. The Intimidate does connect with Kartana, which could be helpful for Melvin, but that Cresselia we've already seen being super threatening to this Landorus and, you know,
and to Snorlax as well,
because
of tactics.
Exactly. Looks like we're just going to see some attacks coming out. A superpower from that Landorus, not able to pick up the KO onto Kartana, though. 2 hit points remaining, and that's going to give Paul enough hit points to fire off a Bloom Doom.
Yeah, it's a close one there, but Kartana surviving is a big deal. This is going to be a huge damage swing because it survived.
The Bloom Doom from Kartana, only made possible by those final 2 hit points after the superpower from Landorus firing into Snorlax. the very definition of a soft target for this Bloom Doom. About 50% hit points, which means that the berry will be activating on Snorlax. Cresselia also going for the Toxic, so putting that timer on Snorlax immediately.
So let's go for the high horsepower. It's going to finish off Cartana. So still a pretty solid turn for Meldon there. Perhaps realizing there was a good chance he wasn't going to pick up that knockout and able to clinch it anyway. Mm-hmm. But that Toxic on Snorlax is a big deal. And even though that Bloom Doom seems like it didn't make much of a difference because Snorlax healed up anyway, effectively getting rid of that berry, also very helpful. Snorlax doesn't want to spend a bunch of time recycling mm-hmm. while it's inflicted with Toxic because it's going to keep adding up in damage. Probably still not a great turn for Paul, but he's done a good job of neutralizing that Snorlax. I think recognizing that Snorlax mm-hmm. Becoming a huge problem, building a bunch of curses, is the most likely way he's going to lose this set.
Yeah, Melvin definitely in a better position this game too than he was in game one. Switches out that Landorus, locked into the superpower for Tapu Lele this time. So bringing the Tapu Lele for a little bit more offensive pressure here. Kangaskhan out on the field for Paul will go ahead and Mega Evolve. Not able to get a fake out off anymore thanks to the psychic terrain from Tapu Lele. Kangaskhan, it looks like, just goes for the low kick instead on Snorlax. Paul accurately reading that, making sure that Snorlax is not able to deal as much damage as it wants to. Not going for the recycle, just going for a return means a lot of damage on to Kangaskhan. But a Trick Room from Cresselia after this Toxic tick means that Melvin's only real Trick Room counter has just fainted.
That's almost exactly the opposite of what happened in game one, right?
Yeah.
Snorlax switched in on the Trick Room, and this game, Paul deals with Snorlax just as he's setting up Trick Room.
Mm-hmm.
Certainly, Paul's team doesn't look like the standard Trick Room team you might imagine, with a bunch of really slow Pokemon, but the way his Pokemon are trained, almost all of them are a little stouter than you might expect. Not fast, but they can do a bunch of damage and they can take hits. So this Trick Room likely to give him a much bigger mm-hmm. advantage than Melvin, whose team's a little bit quicker outside of that Snorlax.
Yeah, Landorus, Therian switching in here just to get that Intimidate off onto Kangaskhan to try to limit some of the damage from Paul. Can't imagine it sticking around in the face of that Cresselia. Just trying to cycle as many Intimidates as possible here.
Yeah, and that's tough too. You know, even if it is going to immediately leave the game, you have to reveal that fourth Pokemon. We mm-hmm. saw how big of a deal it was in the first game that Paul never had to do that. Gave him a little bit of an advantage, even though this second game is pretty even. And again, Paul hasn't revealed his final Pokemon. That's information Melvin's going to try to want to force out. Intimidate does help him do that, where Kangaskhan, or Paul may not want to leave Kangaskhan in battle, especially against this Tapu Lele, but it's going for the ally switch.
Yeah, ally switch, Tapu Lele, trying to avoid some damage here from the Cresselia. The Ice Beam is successfully avoided, only dealing a little bit of damage to Tapu Lele, but Tapu Lele also has to deal with this return from Kangaskhan with the Intimidate, with the changes to Parental Bond, not enough damage to pick up that KO, but the superpower from Landorus is. So getting a lot of value out of that ally switch.
Yeah, that was a great play. We do see that, once again, Kangaskhan's reduced power parental bond failing to pick up a knockout it would have mm-hmm. picked up in the past. And it's a tough spot for Paul. Despite getting the speed advantage and having Kangaskhan move first, it doesn't matter if you don't pick up a knockout and all the Pokemon get to act anyway. A really, really strong ally switch there. And something Paul's going to have to keep in mind if this set continues, but we're in an interesting spot here.
Yeah, that Heatran as the final Pokemon for Paul puts Melvin in a really interesting position. We already know about the Choice Scarf on that Landorus. Currently locked into Superpower, probably needs to switch out to reset something because it can't do anything to the Cresselia, but can't also lock into an Earthquake because then it won't also be able to do anything to Cresselia.
Yeah, this is a really tough Pokemon to wind up as one of the final couple of Pokemon against Paul. He's really going to want to get this knockout as quickly as he can, and there it is. Landorus can be locked into one move.
Yeah, no switch from Landorus, locked into the Superpower for the rest of the game. Heat Wave will pick up the KO on the Tapu Lele.
The rest of the game's not going to last long for Landorus.
Landorus doesn't get another superpower off, just the damage from Heat Wave and Ice Beam, enough for Paul to pick up both of those KOs. And Melvin's final Pokemon's going to have to be great. Tapu Koko, pretty good Pokemon. Not super concerned about Cresselia, but there's a lot of time left, and it's going to be an uphill battle for that Pokemon.
Yeah, there is a lot of health that needs to be burned through by Tapu Koko here, and a lot of turns of Trick Room as well.
Yep, there's going to be a Protect from Tapu Koko, protecting into a potential substitute from the Heatran as well. There's only so much stalling you can do in Trick Room, but Paul not going for the substitute, just going for the damage.
Yeah, I mean, kind of no need, right? A combination of Earth Power and Ice Beam likely to pick up a knockout. Mm-hmm. We're going to see the advantage of that Ice Beam Cresselia we don't see very often, but we do see the substitute this turn.
Substitute here, no Protect from Tapu Koko, so it will be the Toxic on, the Psyshock on the Cresselia to attack the the Tapu Koko. Melvin just giving a taunt on the way out here with Tapu Koko on Cresselia. Heatran behind the substitute. Looks like Paul Chua will be advancing to the top four.
Yeah, that's, I think Melvin throwing in the towel there. Realizes that he's played a great tournament, but Tapu Koko simply can't do this much damage.
There's a Thunderbolt to break the substitute. The hands are shook, and Tapu Koko about to go down to this Cresselia Psyshock and the Heatran's Earth Power. Paul Chua, 2-0, really strong performance here, knocks out Singapore's hope, advances to the top four, and is looking at a repeat and some revenge on this tournament after last year.
Yeah, incredibly impressive run to be able to make it to the top four 2 years in a row. Does beat the representative from at least the rating zone that knocked him out last year, so that's as much revenge as he's going to get from a player perspective. Really amazing. 2 years in a row with two very different teams making it to the semifinals. And, he's still got a chance to go all the way this year. There are only three players remaining. Mm-hmm. The player we saw defeat him last time on stream has also been eliminated. Yeah. So Paul's odds are looking pretty good right now.
Yeah, there is no one left who can stop Paul Chua, it looks like. But we will have to see, because he will be advancing to the top four, joining Alberto Lara and Jeremy Rodriguez, who have already advanced to top four. Only one more person to be decided to join them in the top four. That will be one of either Lynn Duel or Justin Burns for the other match happening over on the main stage.
How are you feeling coming off that stage?
I'm feeling pretty good. That win allowed me to get my day two invite to Worlds this year, so that makes me feel pretty happy.
Yeah, congratulations. What does that mean to you?
It means a lot. Going to this event, I really didn't expect to do well or even get that day two invite, because the gap between me and everyone else was pretty large. So I just came here to have fun and yeah.
What do you think would you attribute your success to? If you came here not being sure that you'd be able to do that, why were you able to?
I think the main reason why is because I'm not really spending too much time stressing about my performance or whatever. So I just go into each game and have fun.
Did you have fun in this game? Tell us a little bit about the match.
Yeah, it was pretty fun. The main issue for his team was the Snorlax, because the way I would beat it was to just set up Trick Room, but the Snorlax, since it's slow, it would exert pressure. So I had used Toxic on it to slowly lower its health and maybe force him to use Recycle a bit.
And now you're moving into the top four. As you look at the rest of the top cut, are you really interested in playing anyone in particular, or really hoping you won't have to hit someone?
Honestly, I feel I'm probably gonna lose top four finals, because they all seem like they're pretty well prepared for my kind of team.
Well, your expectations so far have been wrong, and you've been successful, so we wish you even more success. Thank you so much.